In a course I recently took at my university, we were introduced to Dirichlet's function. This function has a valid, yet odd setup. If an input to the function is a rational number like 4, negative 2/3, or 5/6, the output is 1. If an input to the function is an irrational number, like the square root of 2 or pi, the output is 0. Since rational and irrational numbers are both real numbers, this function can be plotted on a standard two-dimensional graph like this, with the function values of rational number inputs in blue and those of irrational number inputs in red. However, the rational and irrational numbers are dense in the real numbers, meaning that between any two different real numbers, we can find a rational number and we can find an irrational number. Therefore, this graph is just an approximation, as between any two points on this graph, there exists an infinite amount of rational and irrational numbers. This function definitely wasn't something I had ever seen at the time, but then our instructor took the lesson a step further, asking, "So, what is the limit of this function as x approaches 0?" Now, most people would probably say one of two things at this point. One is, "What is a limit? I don't know calculus." If you fall into this category, I wouldn't run away just yet. Knowing calculus is not a prerequisite for being able to discover and analyze limits. However, if you've been through an introductory calculus course, your response would probably be something like, "How would I even start trying to figure that out?" First, let's all get on the same page by building up some intuition for what a limit is. The limit of a function is about determining the value that a function approaches as inputs to the function approach a specific value. Let's start by looking at this function and trying to determine what the limit of the function is as we approach the input value of x equals 3. If we look at the inputs that are near x equals 3, and then look at the corresponding output values, we see that those values appear to be approaching 2. Thus, the limit of the function as x approaches 3 is 2, which we can write using this notation. Now, let's look at a function where it is not defined at a point, in this case at x equals 2. If we want to find the limit of the function as x approaches 2, we need to remember that the key idea with respect to limits is that we only care about what's going on near x equals 2, not at the value itself. Again, if we look at the inputs that are near x equals 2, and then look at the corresponding output values, those values appear to be approaching 1. Thus, the limit of the function as x approaches 2 is 1. However, it's also possible for a limit to not exist for an input value on a function. If we look at this function and desire to know what the limit of it is as x approaches 0, we find an issue. If we approach x equals 0 from the left, we see that the function values approach negative 1. But if we approach x equals 0 from the right, we see that the function values instead approach 1. An important characteristic of a limit is that the function value that is attained as we approach the input value from the left must match the function value attained as we approach it from the right. If this does not occur, then we say that the limit does not exist, notated as DNE. A technique that introductory calculus students sometimes use when trying to prove the limit behavior of more involved functions, like this, is to choose values that get closer and closer to the input value from both sides, and then put them and their associated function values into tables. If the function values for the left side approach a value that matches that of the right side, then the limit exists. Otherwise, like in this example, the limit does not exist. Now that we have a grasp on what a limit is, let's try to use the tools we've developed to look at the limit of Dirichlet's function as x approaches 0. This function is very difficult to analyze graphically, as the density of rational and irrational numbers makes it hard to see what's going on around x equals 0. Even zoomed in around x equals 0, there are an infinite number of zeros and ones for the function values. If we build a table of values from the left and right using some rational numbers, we see that the function values are all ones, so they definitely approach 1. However, if we do the same with irrational numbers, we see that the function values are all zeros, so they approach 0 instead. Even approaching the input value from the left and right in different ways causes us to get different results. So, does this mean that the limit does not exist, or are we just missing something here? It appears that the intuition we've built up so far isn't enough to analyze Dirichlet's function. So maybe a better question to ask ourselves at this point is, what do we want a limit to be? First, we want to be able to get arbitrarily close to an input value and make sure that the associated function values approach what would be the limit value. Second, it shouldn't matter how we approach the input value. We should be able to approach it using big steps from the left, with small steps from the right, or even an oscillation that settles near it. No matter what the steps are, as long as the steps eventually converge on the input value, the associated function value should all approach the same value. Basically, we want an approach similar to finding a limit with a table of values, but doing so in an infinite manner. In fact, the idea of taking an infinite number of steps towards a value is the same as building a convergent sequence. First of all, a sequence is an infinitely long list of numbers whose ordering matters, meaning we cannot switch around any numbers. If the sequence happens to follow a pattern, we can also write it as a function. Its input, usually denoted with the letter n, is the index of the element in the list, starting from 1, and its output is the value in the list at that place. This functional relationship between the index and the value of each element lends itself nicely to an x-y pair that we can graph point by point to visualize it better. Now, let's figure out what it means for a sequence to converge. In this example, this sequence's values appear to be approaching 2. So let's first start by drawing a long tube around that value line with the same distance above and below it. If there exists a point on the x-axis where every sequence value from there out to infinity on the right falls within the tube, then we can reason that the values of the sequence eventually get trapped around 2. If we extend this idea so that the tube can be drawn using any non-zero distance above and below 2, thinking of that distance as being very small, and we can still find a value on the x-axis where every value from there out to infinity on the right falls within the tube, then we have shown that the sequence's values eventually get trapped arbitrarily close to 2. In other words, we've reasoned quite thoroughly that the sequence's values eventually approach 2. And so, we say that the sequence converges to 2. Another useful way to visualize this convergence is on a number line, where if we choose any distance around 2, then we should be able to find a point in the sequence where all the points at and after it should be trapped within these bounds. This visualization also lines up a lot more closely to our original idea of using an infinite number of steps to approach a value. Using our previous example, we can notate this convergence property as follows, saying the limit of the sequence an equals 2, or more explicitly as the limit of the sequence 2 over n plus 2 equals 2. This notation looks a lot like the limit notation we first introduced, and that's no mistake. In fact, this notation is shorthand for the limit as n approaches infinity of the sequence an equals 2. We've successfully figured out a way to model taking an infinite number of steps towards a value in a single dimension, and now we'll extend that to finding a functional limit in 2 dimensions. Now, if we have a sequence and a function, and we apply the function to every number in the sequence, which we'll notate by using the sequence as an input to the function, notice that the result is another sequence. Let's take a sequence that converges to an input value of interest for a function, and then observe how that sequence is transformed by the function. If that resultant sequence also converges to a value, then that value is a candidate for being the limit of the function as x approaches the input value. Remember that this is just one way of approaching the input value. It shouldn't matter what sequence we use to approach the input value, but applying the function to every one of those possible input sequences should result in a sequence that converges to the same value. If this is the case, then we can say that the limit of the function as x approaches the input value equals that same resulting value. However, showing that every possible sequence that converges to the input value works in this way is extremely difficult, if not impossible, seeing as there are infinitely many sequences that converge to any one value. Although this way of thinking about limits using sequences is sometimes not extremely useful for showing that a limit exists, it's great for showing that a limit does not exist. If we can find just two sequences that converge to the same input value, but applying the function to them results in sequences that converge to different values, then we could conclude that the limit does not exist. For example, let's look at the function sine of 1 over x, where we'd like to find the limit of this function as x approaches 0. As we approach 0 as an input, the function just oscillates faster and faster between negative 1 and 1, and so the limit shouldn't exist as x approaches 0. Let's prove that the limit does not exist, starting with these two cleverly chosen sequences. Although we won't show it explicitly here, both of these sequences actually do converge to 0, so they converge to our input value. If we look at the sequence resulting from applying the function to the first one, it is made up of an infinite number of zeros, and so that sequence definitely converges to 0. The function applied to the other sequence produces one made up of an infinite number of 1s, which similarly converges to 1. Since the two input sequences converge to the same value, but the output sequences converge to different values, we have shown that the limit of the function as x approaches 0 does not exist. Now that we have developed some precise ideas around the existence of a limit for a function as we approach an input value, let's again return to Dirichlet's function and see about finding the limit of it as x approaches 0. Since we've just experienced the process of showing that a limit does not exist, let's go ahead and try that approach first. We need to find two sequences that both converge to 0, yet when the function is applied to them, the resulting sequences converge to different values. Since the function only ever attains values of 0 and 1, if we could find two sequences that converge to the input value of 0, though when applying the function to them, one converges to 0 and the other to 1, then we will have done just that. Since rational number inputs to the function produce a value of 1, if we could create a sequence of rational numbers that approach 0, then applying the function to it would produce a sequence composed of only 1s, making it converge to 1. Similarly, irrational number inputs to the function produce a value of 0, so if we could construct a sequence of irrational numbers that approach 0, then applying the function to it would produce a sequence composed of only zeros, making it converge to 0. This would give us exactly what we need, and it turns out we can do just that. To create the sequence of rational numbers that converges to 0, let's choose any negative rational number that's to the left of 0 on the real number line. That will be the first number in the sequence. Since rational numbers are dense in the real numbers, we can find a rational number between that value and 0, which will be our second number. Between the second number and 0, there's another rational number that will be our third number, and we can continue on like this infinitely. Similarly, we'll create the sequence of irrational numbers starting with a positive irrational number to the right of 0 as our first number, just to be a little different and to make visualizing the coming results a little easier. Since the irrational numbers are also dense to the real numbers, we can find an irrational number between the first number and 0, which will be our second number, and so on like this infinitely. Thus, we have constructed two sequences that converge to our input value of 0. When we apply the function to our sequence of rational numbers, we get a sequence composed of only 1s, making the resulting sequence converge to 1. When we apply the function to our sequence of irrational numbers, we get a sequence composed of only zeros, making the resulting sequence converge to 0. The output sequences converge to different numbers, and therefore we can finally conclude that the limit of Dirichlet's function as x approaches 0 does not exist. However, I will admit that it's a bit disappointing to build up all those ideas and tools just to find out that the limit doesn't exist. So, let's modify Dirichlet's function to get a more rewarding result. Instead of mapping the rational number inputs to the number 1, let's instead map them to their own input values, but leave the irrational number inputs mapped to 0. The difference between the original and modified Dirichlet functions is that we now get all of the rational numbers lying on a sort of y equals x graph. Let's say that we still want to find the same limit, that of the function as x approaches 0. If we were to take a sequence of irrational numbers that approach 0 and apply the function to it, we get what we saw before, an endless number of zeros, meaning that the resulting sequence converges to 0. What's interesting now is that if we take a sequence of rational numbers that approaches 0 and apply the function to it, the resulting sequence also converges to 0. In fact, we can even create a sequence of mixed rational and irrational numbers, and applying the function to it results in a sequence that oscillates between 0 and numbers getting closer to 0, which means that the resulting sequence also converges to 0. This behavior is difficult to observe with the current visualization, so here is a more direct animation of the steps of the resulting sequence. I'll state the following without a formal proof, but encourage you to research it yourselves. When we apply this modified Dirichlet function to any possible sequence that converges to 0, the resulting sequence will also converge to 0, which means that the limit of the modified Dirichlet function as x approaches 0 exists and is equal to 0. Now, isn't that satisfying? Before we conclude, I would like to address something that may be on the minds of those who have been through calculus before, and that is why we didn't cover how to show a limit exists using the precise definition of a limit, also known as the epsilon-delta definition. I won't go into the definition's details here, but I will say that I didn't want to add another layer of complexity on top of what we already have worked out. However, the epsilon-delta definition is very interesting and useful in its own right, and it makes me kind of sad that most people who are not math majors will see it introduced in one class session, almost as a footnote, and then never have to revisit it ever again. I will leave you with this thought, though. It turns out that the epsilon-delta definition of a limit, and the idea we explored today that a limit exists if all sequences that converge to the input value should all converge to the same value when the function is applied to them, are equivalent. If any of these deeper ideas about limits have intrigued you, I would highly recommend studying and/or taking a course in real analysis. This course is also known in some undergraduate circles as Introduction to Analysis or Advanced Calculus, as in my case. Those familiar with calculus will absolutely have their minds blown with respect to derivatives and integrals and how to deal with proving facts about them rigorously. With all that said, thanks for watching.